Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. All praise belongs to Allah, and may His peace and blessings be upon His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I welcome you, dear viewers, to this episode where we are asking the question, what can you do for Islam? Now, helping us to look at this subject, we have our dear Sheikh Abdur Raheem McCarthy from the USA, Sheikh Saleem Al Aamry from the UAE, Sheikh Abdul Bari Yahya from the USA, and Sheikh Mamdouh Muhammad from the USA. Now, looking at the idea of what can you do for Islam, or what can you do for the Ummah, what can you do for the Muslims? We see that, you know, not everyone can be a scholar. This might be, you know, the best thing or the highest thing that you can do in terms of need for the Ummah, but it doesn't mean that anything less is going to have less of an impact or less of a reward. For example, being a school teacher, this is something that is, you know, a basic ingredient, because without a school teacher, you can't get to, you know, turning the child into a scholar. So in that same way that we need to have people, you know, looking after these basic things, it means that we can't ignore these, and we have to make sure they're fulfilling these roles. Now, starting with you, Sheikh Abdur Raheem, you know, how can you advise, you know, the Muslims in their community to make sure that they're fulfilling these holes, to make sure that the Ummah is healthy and functioning properly? How can we make sure that, you know, we can properly gauge exactly what's needed and what we can do?
Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah, wa ba'd. Alhamdulillah, we can say that there's so many things you can do for Islam. It doesn't have to be the scholar in the masjid. Perhaps that's the highest status, but you never know. If you have the true, pure ikhlas, the pure intention, perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you more reward for something else. But what we need to do as Muslims, we need to put the principle in front of us that the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يحب إذا عمل أحدكم عمل أن يتقنه. He loves, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves from His servant, if he does any action, that he perfects it, the perfection. So whatever that action is, whether you're a school teacher, a bus driver, you're a soldier, a police officer, a doctor, a lawyer, whatever it is you do, whatever your role is, a parent, a brother, a sister, whatever you are, perfect that thing. Perfect it. And you're going to see the effect and what it does for Islam. When you act upon it, you perfect it. And if we all strive for perfection, and I recall one time, our brothers was telling us that we say, for example, let's be like Sheikh Mbaz. And Sheikh Mbaz is a major scholar of our time that we all look up to, we all love dearly. May Allah have mercy upon him.
Amen.
And they say, who are we? We can't be like Sheikh Mbaz. He said, you know what? You're probably right. But let's just say we all strove to do that. If all of us as student knowledge reach 25%, which is possible, it's not difficult for us. If we really strive, we can reach that, if we reach that 25%, what would it do for the Ummah? Some of the scholars said, when they talked about how you should learn about Islam, Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, he said, learn three masail, three issues daily about Islam. Learn something new about Islam. And do the math, and 360, how many is that in a year? Let's just say you learn one issue a day. 360 things you learn new about Islam in that year, and then you pass it on to others. Look at the effect. So we're talking about perfecting anything you do. And we have to have this as our principle, as the foundation for us, the perfecting. And then also to know that helping Islam is not just in da'wah, and in the direct da'wah of any calling to Allah and His Messenger. It could be in your hospital.
Definitely. So now, Sheikh Mamdouh, we know from the history of Islam, we've seen people who might have been scholars as well as warriors. They might have been scholars as well as doctors. They might have been people who filled many posts. Enlighten us a little bit just about some of the great examples that we can look up to.
I will talk about one simple example, which is the invention of the zero, the smallest number.
As simple as it gets, right?
Yeah, as simple as it gets. There's nothing more simpler than this invention led to what? Led to every invention that we see nowadays.
The computers, you can't
have binary
code without a zero.
The whole mathematics science would not have been completed. And this goes back to the concept of perfection. We cannot reach this level until we perfect our job. However, this perfection also needs something before it, which is taqwa. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهِ. Be more mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Watch Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all what you do. And yes, this will lead you to increase your knowledge. So perfection requires this type of taqwa, and that's what we said, that back to basics. When every Muslim goes to the basics, we will definitely have some of those scholars who reach 20% of the scholar or 25%, and it goes like this.
Indeed. Now, it's interesting looking at that point of taqwa and ikhlas.
And you could not
because we know of the hadith where the Prophet, peace be upon him, said that one of the first people to enter the hellfire would be a scholar. A scholar, meaning he had the knowledge, but he used it for the wrong purposes. Yeah. Now, that shows that, I mean, you might get 100% on your exam, but it doesn't mean you have true ikhlas. Ikhlas means that you are going to really say, what can I do for the ummah? And that means that every single one of us, we might be limited, you might not be the smartest in your class, but it doesn't mean you can't actually contribute and end up being a great hero for the ummah. Indeed. So Sheikh Abdul Bari, can you, I suppose, expand on this a little
bit? Oh, subhanAllah. You know, Al-Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, he was sitting in front of his teacher, and he of course with the other students, Ishaq ibn Ibrahim al-Rahway. And during those days, there were some books of hadith, but there was no book or collection of only authentic hadith. And so his teacher said, gave him an idea, and he said, if only somebody had, collected just the books of authentic hadith to make it easy for the general people, so that they won't, those who don't know the science of hadith or the narrators, whether they're trustworthy or not, they could just read this hadith and they say they would feel comfortable that, it's authentic. And so Imam Bukhari, rahimahullah, he said, that fell into my heart. And from that time on, look what he did. He went from one place to the next. He spent his whole lifetime in search of hadith and collecting that. But look at the effects of it in the ummah. Subhanallah. The khatib, the speaker or a speaker gives a hadith. And then you might not have heard the hadith before, and all of a sudden, he says, Rawah al-Bukhari. And the whole ummah is at peace, subhanAllah. Did you how much peace he gave to the ummah
for
that book, the most authentic book. But you know what he said? The reason why he did it, he mentioned also another reason. He said, because I wanted it to be a proof of my contribution when in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment, when Allah asked him, what did you give to this ummah? And what a great collection he gave and what great peace he gave to the ummah. So this is a great example when somebody is sincere, when somebody has that determination. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّ. And we made them أَئِمَّ. يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا صَبَرُوا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُقِنُونَ. When they're patient, and they have the yaqeen, certainty in our ayats, they're strong in faith, strong in iman. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them imams. So we call each other Shaykh this and Shaykh that. You can't say Shaykh al-Bukhari, it doesn't even sound right. You don't say Shaykh al-Malik, you say Imam Malik, al-Imam Malik, al-Imam Abu Hanifa, al-Imam Ahmad, al-Imam al-Shafi'i. Allah made them a'immas because they had that sincerity and then the determination and they had the high aspirations. And they went for it, and look at the effects of it in the ummah.
In all aspects, the Muslims throughout history, something we need to always focus on as well. And no Muslim has doubt about the religious side, what the Muslims have reached to. But we do tend to forget, because now we see what the West has reached in technology, and we look where we are in our Muslim countries, unfortunately. But when you look throughout history, don't forget that these same Westerners, or the Europeans, they used to send their children to us, to study from the Muslims.
Even without sending them, the zero itself tells us. All this technology is based on the zero.
On the zero. And also, they used to tell us, by the way, they would have their children dressed like Muslims.
Yes.
Wearing the turban and the Muslim dress, so they could be like the smart people, like the clever
people. I don't know, the gown when people graduate? That's the gown, the uniform, or that's what the people of Andalus, the scholars of Andalus, the teachers and so forth, they used to wear.
We know universities themselves were begun by the Muslims. The first universities were built by Muslims. And it's interesting to note how you mentioned, for example, the collections of ahadith. I mean, this was something that was unprecedented. The zero was unprecedented. Universities were unprecedented, which meant Muslims weren't just followers. They were innovators, they were thinkers.
Yes.
And that doesn't mean that we can't do this in our times. I mean, the internet, when we were born, we would have never even thought about the internet. Life went on, but now we can't survive without it. So there's nothing to say that, we can't be the next ones to be thinking forward.
Just very recently, the Hotmail.com is invented by a Muslim, by the way.
Yeah.
an Indian Muslim, and his story is very well known among the Ahsaw. It's very recent.
Yeah.
And one of the best technologies that helped.
There are so many examples. We're going to go to a very short break, inshallah, and continue with this because I like where things are going. So, dear viewers, do stay tuned, and inshallah, we will be back after a very short moment. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, dear viewers. We are here looking at the question, what can you do for Islam? Now, just before the break, Sheikh Mamduh May Allah reward him was giving the example of Hotmail. I mean, again, Hotmail is something that was an innovation. And it's something that, you know, we can barely live without today. And this is something that, as he mentioned, a Muslim contributed to. So this shows that, you know, the legacy of invention and innovation, of course, innovation in worldly matters, is something that hasn't stopped among the Muslim Ummah. Indeed, this is something that should belong to us. We should be at the forefront. So just to ask you, Sheikh Saleem, how can we continue? I mean, we know that, you know, Islam demands to be educated, to be intelligent, to be thinking. How can we make sure that our communities are educated and healthy and at the forefront of all of these matters?
Bismillah. Salatu salam ala Rasulullah wa alayhi wa sahbihi min wala. It is here that the concept of the ilm or the knowledge itself in Islam, it is so broad. It's not only the religious one. Because here we have, sometimes we have found some people, they draw the line, or there's no room actually, or this dichotomy between what is mundane or worldly and what is spiritual. Islam is both. And the early Muslims, they understood this very well. And that's why you mentioned that they were physicians, they were physicists, and they were mathematicians and logicians and jurists, the same person. Okay? So the Islam is in need of all of these things. And everyone should excel in his field. Excel in his field, as the Prophet ﷺ said, Inna Allah kataba al-ihsan ala kulli shay. So Allah ordained perfection and excellence. You have to excel in your field. Wherever you are, you can serve the deen. You're a teacher, excel in your field. Engineer, excel in your field, and you invent. A doctor, excel in your field. So everyone has to excel in his field. And this will, inshallah, promote the ummah and increase and change the status of the ummah. And at the same time that you have to be not only excelling in that particular field, and at the same time you are a true Muslim.
Of course.
Okay, not that you are holding PhD holder and you can't read the Fatiha correctly.
This is the key. And you look at the effect, we go back to the domino effect. Imagine the Muslim practices Islam himself and then excels in his field. Imagine the effect it's going to have, first of all, on our societies by making them return where they should be originally. And imagine the effect it's going to have even on the non-Muslims. Because non-Muslims and Muslims today, they have this misconception that you can't be somebody who is a professional and a practicing Muslim at the same time. Which, I mean, we could give several examples of people who have excelled in their fields and they're practicing Muslims. There's too many examples, even in the time we live in. However, so we need to always go back to this, that you can do both, and you can enjoy the pleasure of being successful in the dunya affairs in this world, and being successful in your religion, and inshallah, being successful in the hereafter, that inshallah ta'ala.
There are many suggestions and ideas that can help a lot. But I recall one that had been done by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, which I think he is the first leader in the world that he used this technique of using the prisoners of war to teach the Muslims reading and writing.
To emancipate themselves.
Yeah. And they got, in return, they got freedom. This is an example. I think we need to adopt it now because the percentage of illiteracy in the Muslim world is very high.
Illiteracy. Yes.
In some countries, in Egypt per se, it's 49% of the Egyptians are illiterate.
That's a high number.
So every two people, one is educated and one is uneducated. And the uneducated is pulling this down, and the educated one fails to raise him up or her. So we need at least any Muslim now who knows how to read and write can teach 10 of the Muslims who are illiterate. And in this way, try to imagine if 1 million is going to do this. So in a very short time, we can teach 10 million.
Imagine the ajr this guy would get.
The Muslim Ummah, they have the potential. They
do have the potential.
We have the people who are capable. And the only thing we miss and we lack is the unity among us.
We can use the mosques, we can use our homes, we use any facility to do this job. And I think it can take very limited time. I don't want to say 6 months or 1 year. It can be done in 1 year.
I like where you're going with this because you're thinking forwards.
Yes.
You're seeing the problem and now saying, well, how's it going to be fixed? I mean, it's not going to be fixed just by talking about it. We need to actually have a plan, a mass literacy campaign. Yes. I mean, this is something that would be possible. It wouldn't be something that would be too hard. As the Sheikh said, we need unity, we need support. But then in the end, we only need a few people. A few motivated people would be enough. We have the money, there's no doubt about this. You have benevolent Muslims willing to give this. What we need now are the forward thinkers and the motivation. Now, speaking about this with motivation, I suppose this can be one of the issues. I remember one of our shuyukh, may Allah have mercy upon him, said, whoever dedicates their life for the service of their religion, they're going to become tired. It's not something easy. However, he's going to live in a status of greatness, die and be raised to Allah in greatness. Now, I want to ask you, Sheikh Abdul Bari, how can we maintain that, you know, momentum, sincerity and motivation? Because it's going to be hard. How do we remind ourselves why we're doing these things?
Well, of course, you know, anytime we contribute, no matter what, how small or how big it is, we have to realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, will reward us, and He knows it. And even though nobody sees it and knows it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still knows it. And so we ourselves, we have to find a way where we can also not only contribute, but have others also contribute. Even if we can't contribute ourselves, we can find others also and use the resources that the Ummah has. And so you don't have to have, you don't have to know everything. You don't have to do everything. But there's a lot of resources out there. And maybe, like for example, in our community, sometimes I don't have enough time to teach everybody. So sometimes when I'm gone, we will find someone, and it might not be related to the deen, somebody who's working for Microsoft, somebody who's working for Boeing. And I'm asking them, said, give me the best. Give me the best that you have from your experience and time that you got so you can teach the youth. And we as Muslims, we have so much resources, but we have to use that. And we have to take the best from each community. We have to take it, and we have to learn from each other and improve that way. And so instead of thinking you can do everything, because when you say, especially when a lot of people, when they want to contribute, they start doing maybe too much, and then they end up failing without concentrating and focusing on, you know, little things and also getting other people to help. So it's very important to delegate, and it's very important to consult also, because when you consult, it increases participation also. Yeah. So, you know, work together.
There's two things on what he was talking about exactly. And that is, we have to realize as Muslims as well, a lot of people, when they think about, like you talk about the literacy campaign or something like this, you know, it's too big. Maybe I can't do it. But what we have to realize is when you get the ball bouncing and you start, even if you don't accomplish it, maybe somebody else will come and continue from that stage. And don't forget the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, man sanna fil islami sunnatan hasana, that whoever, and he has a good sunnah, and he reinvents or brings back a good sunnah, or establish something good, which people follow after him, he will have the ajr, the reward of that, and the reward of all the people who do with it until yawm al-qiyam, to the day of judgment. So let's not forget that. When we say, what can we do for the ummah? Let's get started. Let's work. Let's act. Let's be big thinkers. Even we don't accomplish. And then maybe somebody else will come from our idea and they'll continue. And that's the second thing I want to point out, which was Sheikh Abdul Bari was talking similar about it, is that we have all the abilities in ummah. We have so crazy ability in ummah, yes, Islam. Not just the resources, even the minds.
The minds.
The minds. It's been proven that in the Arab world, they have one of the highest rates when it comes to the students of cleverness. But unfortunately, they don't use it properly in a lot of the places. So they have the ability. So what we need to realize as well is a lot of times Muslims, what we do, we make mistakes when working for Islam, is everybody wants to start something from ground zero. The wheels are rolling in a lot of places. Let's build on what our brothers have done. Like the guy said at Walmart, what he said, he said he went and took the best. And now he's wiped everybody out of America.
He wiped everyone out because of that.
Yeah. He's put everybody out of business.
Yes.
So the same thing now, we're doing something with Islamic or in another field. Let's not reinvent the wheel. Let's start from where our brothers have reached and build on that. And you'll see amazing results, inshallah ta'ala.
You know, expanding upon this, the two points you made, something that, you know, always gets me very emotional, subhanAllah. I mean, this channel that we have now wouldn't be here without one man, Sheikh Ahmed Didat rahimahullah. Ahmed Didat, you know, the great da'i, a hero of Islam of our time, wasn't exactly the most educated man in the world. But look at the sincerity and what came out from him. You know, the Islamic Da'wah Center in Melbourne that published the books that I read when I became a Muslim only existed because he visited Melbourne. If it wasn't for him, you wouldn't have Dr. Zakir Naik. You didn't have Dr. Zakir Naik, you wouldn't have this channel. We would not be sitting here. This all goes back to one man. And you see, as you mentioned, dear Sheikh Abdur Raheem, building upon this. Ahmed Didat Rahimullah started with something, and then everyone else built upon this.
And this answers the question that you just raised. How can we keep the momentum among the Muslims to do this? If you want to keep the momentum, just watch Peace TV. This is an example.
And, you will find
all the scholars are motivating
you. The sincerity of the man, mashallah, today, his students mashallah, everywhere.
Mashallah.
Also, the issue is Sheikh Salim about the specialization. Let's go back to Ahmed Didat.
And
even Islamically, he wasn't a great scholar in all the fields of Islam. But in his field, he was the man.
He excelled in that.
Mercy upon him. I remember, because as a youth, he wasn't specialized in every field. Once there was one of the shuyukh was telling us that he was once giving a public talk and he mentioned a hadith, and this hadith wasn't sahih. So this sheikh who was on the podium, on a table with him, he actually called the sheikh back and he whispered to him, he said, "This hadith you mentioned isn't actually sahih." So Sheikh Ahmed Didat rahimahullah went straight back to the audience and he said, "This hadith I mentioned is not sahih. Why? Because the people who know better than me have told me so."
This is the humbleness.
Look at the humility of this man. And this is why we see, you know, I can't tell you how much I love this man. I mean, just the amount of good that has come out. You know, you would go so far as to say that Western da'wah, the da'wah in the Western world, was built upon this man. In all honesty, subhanAllah, I think he's, you know, one of the greatest examples of someone who was very limited in what he had.
Yes.
But look at the effect that he did for the ummah. This should be an inspiration for every single
focused,
one of us.
Because he excelled in what he did.
He excelled in his field.
He was excellent.
So nobody would have said at his time, you know, we need a da'i to talk about comparative religion. Nobody called him to do this. But he did this. He realized there was a need. And look how it benefited the ummah. So I'm going to end this episode, first of all, by thanking all of you, but reminding everyone, make dua that Allah blesses and accepts, you know, the works of our dear Sheikh Ahmed Didat rahimahullah, and place him and his family in the highest ever levels of Jannah.
And all the scholars of Islam.
Ameen, ameen. May Allah reward you all for joining us, inshallah. We hope to have you in our future episodes. And may Allah reward you, dear viewers, and we hope that you've benefited from this topic, and we hope to see you as well, inshallah, in the coming episodes. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.